Hey guys, in this video I have a problem from linear algebra that gives you a matrix and asks you to find whether or not the row vectors are linearly dependent and then whether or not the column vectors are linearly dependent. And it says that for each of your solutions to give a theorem or basically cite some kind of justification for your response. So for this type of question, it's basically testing whether or not you know what the definition of row vectors being linearly dependent in a matrix. If you know what that means, then you can just apply the theorem and come to your answer. So the way I think of linear dependence for rows is that I just think of the theorem that if you convert the matrix A into row echelon form, or REF, if there's a zero row at the bottom or one or more zero rows at the bottom, then the rows of the matrix are linearly dependent. And if you do row echelon form and there are only non-zero rows, then they are linearly independent. So that's the theorem that I'm going to use for the first part of this problem. So there's linear dependence of rows, I guess, if and only if the rank of the matrix A is less than the number of rows of A when A is in row echelon form. So the rank is the number of rows in row echelon form that are non-zero. So it says the same thing as what I just said. If you have a matrix like this where this is non-zero and this is non-zero, then the rank of this would be 2. As far as the number of rows goes, the row rank would be 2 because the zero row doesn't count as part of the rank when you're counting rows. But the number of rows of this matrix is still 3. And this is assuming this is after row echelon form. I think I said that already. So it's the same thing, just stated a bit more formally. So after we have that theorem to justify whether, we can determine linear dependence, then the next thing would be to put this matrix into row echelon form to see whether or not there are zero rows at the bottom. So we're gonna go ahead and do that. The first transformation that I did was R2 plus 2R1 and R3 minus, I think that says 5R1. So that's going to give you 1, 3, negative 2, 9. So the first row doesn't change. 0, 3, negative 3, 6. And 0, negative 2, 9, negative 44. So that just gives you zeros for the rest of this column. Then this next transformation I did was 1/3 R2. And that gives you 1, 3, negative 2, 9. 0, 1, negative 1, 2. And 0, negative 2, 9, negative 44. So this gives me a leading 1 on the second row, and that makes it easier for me to get rid of, you know, the rest of the numbers on this column. So the next thing I did was R3 plus 2R2, and that gives me 1, 3, negative 2, 9, 0, 1, negative 1, 2, 0, 0, 7, negative 40. So in my linear algebra class, we didn't consider that row echelon form had to have a leading 1. Sometimes the definition of row echelon form for some classes is that you need to have the leading numbers of the rows need to be, or the leading coefficients need to be 1. In my case, it didn't have to be, but if it was, then you could just divide by 7 for row 3, so you could say 1/7 row 3 to get another matrix. But even if you divide by 7, you'll still see that the third row is non-zero. So in this case, because this is row echelon form and the rank is 3 and the number of rows is 3 as well, then the theorem does not hold. So this is linearly independent and therefore not linearly dependent. So that's the first answer. And now we can do the second part of the problem. So this says, take the same matrix and determine whether the columns are linearly dependent. So there are a few different ways to do this as well. There is such a thing as column echelon form, and the same thing, reduced column echelon form. So if you wanted to do that, that basically means that instead of having zeros on the bottom, you have zeros on the right, and it's just the same thing kind of transposed. I would not use that method. I would just say, because you can also say that, okay, the columns of A are equal to the rows of A transpose. And then you could just do the same row echelon form of A transpose, and whatever you get for those rows would give you, so if you have 0, what is it, 0, 0 on the last row of A transpose, then you have linear dependence. So basically what I'm saying is you could do 1, you could find the column echelon form, 2, you could do A transpose and do row echelon form, but there's, for this particular problem, there's even another easier theorem where you don't even have to do any calculations. There's another theorem that says if you have more columns than rows, then the columns of vector A are linearly dependent. So the theorem stated formally in my book is any set of m vectors in Rn is linearly dependent if m is greater than n. So if you have, in this matrix, you have 1, 2, 3, 4, m equals 4, so you have 4 vector columns or column vectors in Rn, and the number of rows you have is equal to 3. So 4 is greater than 3, and that holds true, so you know you have to have linear dependence. Knowing this theorem can save you time on this problem because you wouldn't have to transpose and you wouldn't have to do row echelon form again. So you can just use that theorem to say that in this case, they are linearly dependent, the columns, because there are more columns than rows. And that pretty much sums up the method for determining whether rows or column vectors are linearly dependent.